long bone. For size determination, you see the head is directed medially and bicipital groove is anteriorly. So this is right humerus. It has got upper end, shaft and lower end. Upper end has got head, anatomical neck, surgical neck, lesser tubercle anteriorly and greater tubercle laterally, and in front between the two tubercles this bicipital groove or intertubercular sulcus. Head is less than half sphere, it is smooth, it articular, covered by hyaline cartilage, articulates with the glenoid cavity of scapula to form the shoulder joint, ball and socket type of cerumen joint. The neck joins the head and the upper end, rest of the upper end. Surgical neck joins the upper end and the shaft. Lesser tubercle is anteriorly and you can take it. And greater tubercle is laterally. Greater tubercle has got three muscular impressions: upper, middle and lower. Here is upper muscular impression and then we have middle and lower muscular impression. In the bicipital groove or intertubercular sulcus, we have two lips, that is lateral lip and medial lip, and between the two lips there is a floor. So in the upper end we have got head, anatomical neck, surgical neck, lesser tubercle, greater tubercle with three muscular impressions, and bicipital groove or intertubercular sulcus with lateral lip, medial lip and floor. This is shaft. Like the other long bones, the shaft has got three borders and three surfaces. The borders are anterior border, lateral border and medial border. These borders are not clear in the upper half. These borders are somewhat rounded in the upper half. So upper half of the shaft is circular, more or less circular in shape, in cross section, and lower half is triangular. So the shaft has got three borders: anterior border, lateral border and medial border, and three surfaces: anterior lateral surface, anterior medial surface and posterior surface. Anterior lateral surface between anterior border and lateral border, anterior medial surface between anterior border and medial border, and posterior surface between lateral and medial borders. On the middle of the anterior lateral surface we have a roughened V-shaped deltoid tuberosity for deltoid muscle, and in the upper and in the middle one third of the posterior surface we have an obliquely placed groove that is called the radial groove or spiral groove. This is for the passage of radial nerve into fundal brachii vessels, posterior surface. So in the shaft we have three borders and three surfaces. Borders are anterior border, lateral border and medial border. Surfaces are anterior lateral surface, anterior medial surface and posterior surface. On the anterior lateral surface we have V-shaped deltoid tuberosity, and on the posterior surface we have radial groove or spiral groove. Lower end, this is the lower end. In the lower end we have articular part and non-articular part. Articular part is smooth, covered by hyaline cartilage. Articular part articulates with the upper articular part of the upper end of the radius and ulna to form the
articulation,
that is called the elbow joints. Articular part, lateral one and rounded one, head is capitulum. And medial one and pulley shape is trochlear. So in the articular part we have lateral one, rounded, that is called the capitulum, and medial one and pulley shape is called trochlea. Capitulum articulates with the head of the radius, and trochlea articulates with the trochlear notch of the ulna to form the elbow joint. In non-articular part, we have three fossae. Three fossae are on the anterior aspect. We have two fossae. One is radial fossa, that is above the capitulum, and we have coronoid fossa above the trochlea. And on the posterior aspect, we have one fossa, that is olecranon fossa. Olecranon fossa.
And where is the second one? Where is it? So we didn't see it.
Yeah. Radial fossa receives half of the radius inflection of elbow joint.
Okay.
And coronoid fossa receives coronoid portion of ulna inflection of elbow joint. And olecranon fossa accommodates olecranon process of ulna in full extension of elbow joint. The other parts are two epicondyles. We have smaller one, lateral epicondyle, and larger one, we have medial epicondyle. And we have two supracondylar ridges or supracondylar lines. We have lateral supracondylar line, that is downward continuation of lateral border of shaft. And we have medial supracondylar line, that is downward continuation of medial border of shaft. So in the lower end of the humerus, we have articular parts and non-articular parts. In articular parts, we have capitulum and trochlea. In non-articular parts, we have three fossae, two epicondyles, and two supracondylar ridges. Three fossae are radial fossa, coronoid fossa, and olecranon fossa. And two epicondyles are lateral epicondyle and medial epicondyle. And two supracondylar ridges are lateral supracondylar ridge and medial supracondylar ridge. This is about the general features of humerus. Now about the muscle attachments. Some muscles are attached on the humerus. These muscles are on the greater tubercle. There are three muscles attached. These muscles are supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor. So these are sit muscles on the greater tubercle, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor. Okay. Now three muscles are attached on the bicipital groove. One muscle is on the lateral lip, one muscle is on the medial lip, and one muscle is on the floor. On the lateral lip, that is pectoral, is major, and the medial lip, teres is major, and on the floor, latissimus dorsi.
Latissimus dorsi on the floor.
In between two majors.
Okay.
Right major is pectoralis major, lateral major, and medial major is teres major. And between the two, latissimus dorsi. Okay. Now three muscles here, these are sit muscles, and three muscles here on the bicipital groove. Now three muscles here. One muscle here on the lesser tubercle, that is subscapularis. Okay. One muscle here on the V-shaped deltoid tuberosity on the middle of anterior lateral surface of shaft, this muscle is deltoid. And one muscle is here on the middle of medial border of shaft, this muscle is coracobrachialis. Okay, all these are insertions. We have nine insertions. How? Three muscles here on the greater tubercle, these are sit muscles, and three muscles on the bicipital groove, these muscles are two majors and latissimus dorsi, and three muscles here, subscapularis, deltoid, and coracobrachialis. These, it means these four muscles are attached, are inserted on the tubercles of the humerus. These muscles form the rotator cuff muscles. When you study the shoulder joint, you study the rotator cuff muscles that give stability to the shoulder. joint. Now other muscles. Now we come origin. On the lower half of anterior medial and anterior lateral surfaces of the shaft, this is for the origin of brachialis.
And
posterior surface below the radial groove is for medial head of triceps, and an oblique ridge on the posterior surface above the radial groove is for lateral head of triceps, and the shaft on the anterior lateral and anterior medial surfaces we have brachialis, that is muscle of anterior compartment of arm, and on the posterior surface above the radial groove lateral head of triceps, and below the radial groove medial head of triceps. Okay, this triceps is muscle of posterior compartment of arm, and brachialis is one of the muscle of anterior compartment. In the anterior compartment of arm we have three muscles, BBC, that are brachialis and biceps and coracobrachialis. So brachialis is coming here, and biceps is coming from long hand from supraglenoid tubercle of the scapula, and short hand with the coracobrachialis with the tip of the coracoid process of the scapula, and coracobrachialis from the tip of coracoid process of the scapula. Now we come in the lower end. In the lower end, three muscles on the supracondylar ridges. On the lateral supracondylar ridge, upper two-thirds is for the brachioradialis. Lower one-third for extensor carpi radialis longus. You know, in the forearm, there are 20 muscles. 8 in the anterior compartment and 12 in the posterior compartment.
Okay.
These muscles are arranged in two groups, superficial group and deep group.
Okay.
The muscles of the superficial group of the posterior compartment of the forearm are anconius, brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, extensor carpi radialis brevis, extensor digitorum, extensor digiti minimi, and extensor carpi ulnaris.
Easy.
It's very easy. When we will teach you forearm, it's very, very easy. It's very easy.
So the origin of the extensor carpi radialis is from where?
Extensor carpi radialis longus from lower one-third of lateral supracondylar ridge of humerus, and brachioradialis from upper two-third of lateral supracondylar ridge of humerus.
Humerus.
And one muscle is here on the medial supracondylar ridge, that is lower one third. This is for pronator teres. Pronator teres. It is a muscle of superficial group of anterior compartment of forearm. This is pronator teres, lower one third of medial supracondylar line of humerus. So three muscles on the supracondylar ridges. Now we come three epicondyles. Now, at the back of lateral epicondyle is for anconius. Anconius is at the back of lateral epicondyle. And on the lateral epicondyle, there is common origin of extensors of forearm. And on the medial epicondyle, there is common origin of flexors of forearm. Here we mean that medial epicondyle is common flexor origin, and lateral epicondyle is for the common extensor origin. What we mean by common flexor origin and common extensor origin? You know, in the forearm, in the anterior compartment, there are 8 muscles, 5 superficial and 3 deep. Muscles of the deep group, they take origin from anterior surfaces of radius and ulna. Muscles of the superficial group of the anterior compartment, they take origin from here. And these muscles are pronator teres, flexor carpi radialis, palmaris longus, flexor digitorum superficialis, and flexor carpi ulnaris. these five muscles. Out of five, pronator teres is here on the lower one third of lateral supra, of medial supra, condylar line of humerus, and other four muscles here. So this we name as common origin or origin of common flexors of forearm. And here is origin of common extensors of forearm. It means there are seven muscles in the superficial group of the posterior compartment of the forearm. There are five muscles deep group, but they take origin from the posterior surfaces of radius and ulna. Here seven muscles are anconius and brachioradialis and extensor carpalis longus and extensor carpalis brevis and extensor digitorum and extensor digiti minimi and extensor carpi ulnaris. All these muscles come from here, but out of these seven, three come here. Anconius here, extensor carpi radialis longus here, and brachioradialis here. Other four here.
So that's where
this
common.
So these 18 muscles are attached to the humerus. These are very easy if you make the group of three. Three muscles here on the greater tubercle, these are sit muscles. Three muscles here in the bicipital group, this is lady between two majors. And three muscles here, subscapularis, deltoid, and brachioradialis. You can remember these three muscles. And three muscles on the shaft, brachialis, lateral head of triceps and medial head of triceps. And three muscles on the supracondylar ridge, that is brachioradialis, extensor carpi radius longus, and pronator teres. And three muscles on the epicondyles, this is anconius, common extensor origin, and is common flexor origin.
Yes.
Now, nerves related to the humerus. Three nerves are related directly to the humerus. One is axillary nerve, winds around the surgical neck of humerus. With anterior and posterior circumflex humeral arteries. And radial nerve passes, runs in the radial groove on the middle one third of posterior surface of shaft. So radial nerve runs in the radial groove with the profunda brachii vasus. And ulnar nerve runs behind the medial epicondyle of humerus. Sometimes when you are sitting and when you hit your middle epicondyle
yes.
on any edge of the table, that is your medial nerve become compressed against the table and the medial epicondyle. Ulnar nerve. Since ulnar nerve that results in hyperesthesia here in the distribution. This is compressed, stretched
against what?
Yes.
Between this
the cloha.
Yes, reflex the tendons
here. You were present in the morning?
No.
Only you were present in the morning?
No,
yes.
No, only me.
Only you were present?
Yeah.
Okay. So nerves related to the humerus. Radial nerve. No, sorry. Axillary nerve, radial nerve, and ulnar nerve. Okay? If the question is asked, name the structures winding around the surgical nerve, the answer is axillary nerve and anterior and posterior circumflex humeral vessels. If question asks, name the structures passing in the radial groove or spinal groove, the answer is radial nerve and profunda brachii vessels. You know, profunda brachii vessels is a branch of
brachii.
So, now applied about the fracture. Three common sites of fracture are fracture of the surgical neck, fracture of midshaft, and supracondylar fracture. Fracture of surgical neck. If there is fracture of surgical neck,
yes.
What is the result?
Damage
to the axillary nerve. Very good. Fracture of the surgical neck results in damage, injury to the axillary nerve. If axillary nerve is injured, what will happen? Which muscle will paralyze?
Deltoid
and
teres
minor.
Teres minor, yes, yes. Because it's come from cervical 5 and I think 7 or 8.
5 and 6,
yes.
This is branch of posterior colobrachial.
Yes, yes.
So this is deltoid and teres minor paralyzed. If teres, what is the job of teres minor?
What about, you know,
teres minor?
The heel.
Adduction.
After healing, you know, with the
adduction. And maintaining the scalp.
After healing of what?
Of the bone.
And the draw the scapula.
Maintain the scalp in its position. And adduction.
Healing of fracture is a separate story. And regeneration of the nerve is a separate story. Okay. So
there is a regeneration. It
is not related at all with the healing of fracture. It is not at all. No relation. So if surgical neck is fractured, axillary nerve become injured and deltoid and teres minor become paralyzed, you know that teres minor muscle that causes lateral rotation of the shoulder joint and stabilizes the shoulder joint, there other muscles will stabilize and rotate the shoulder joint, there will no, you know, obvious effect. But deltoid, you know, anterior fibers of deltoid are causing flexion and medial rotation. Medial fibers of deltoid or posterior fibers of deltoid are causing extension and lateral rotation, and there are other muscles causing these movements. But you know, medial fibers of deltoid, they cause abduction from 15 to 90 degrees, and there is no other muscle that causes abduction between 15 and 90 degrees. So there will be loss of abduction between 15 and 90 degrees.
Sorry, you said there is no muscles?
So if I lift his arm to 90 degrees, he can lift it. But if I put it here. يعني يقدر من 0 إلى 15 يقدر من 90 لفوق بس بين ما
يقدر. Now, if there is fracture of the mid shaft of the humerus, it results in injury to radial nerve. If radial nerve is injured, what will happen? Because radial nerve supply all the 20 muscles of the posterior compartment of the forearm. So all the posterior compartment forearm muscles become paralyzed. So what is the job of these muscles?
No grip.
What is the job of these muscles?
You can't grip.
No.
What is the action of muscles of posterior compartment of forearm? If you pull this muscle, what? If you pull this muscle, pull this.
Yes. This will become.
What is the job of muscles of anterior compartment of forearm?
Flexion.
And of posterior compartment?
Extension.
Of this joint and fingers. So there will be loss of extension of wrist and fingers. So what will happen? The wrist joint is held in flex position. So this condition is called wrist drop.
Wrist drop.
Okay. And about eye drop, Ahmed will tell you about the eye drop. What is eye drop? I will not tell you. You ask Ahmed after class, he will tell you eye drop. Okay. So this is
eye drop.
What is eye drop? After this class, he will tell you. Okay. So this is injury to the mid shaft of the humerus results in fracture of the mid shaft results in injury to the radial nerve that results in paralysis of the muscles of the posterior compartment of the forearm that results in loss of flexion of the wrist joint, and it means it results in wrist joint held in flex position. In this condition is called wrist drop. Okay?
Okay.
When there is supracondylar fracture, there will be, if there will be injury to the ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve injury will result in paralysis of, you know, ulnar nerve supply 1.5 muscles of the anterior compartment of the forearm and 15 out of 20 muscles of the palm. There are 20 muscles in the palm, 15 are supplied by the ulnar nerve. There are 8 muscles here, 1.5 are supplied by the ulnar nerve and 6.5 are supplied by the median nerve. So it means that if ulnar nerve is injured, what will happen? 15 muscles of the palm. In palm, they are lumbricals. They are. We have four. We have muscle tenarum innervus, muscle hypothalamic innervus, we have 4 umbilicals, 4 palmar introduce, 4 dorsal introduce. So except 5, all these muscles become paralyzed, and action of lumbricals and lumbricals especially, and also the introduce, their job is flexion of metacarpophalangeal joint and extension of interphalangeal joint. If these become paralyzed, opposite phenomenon. So hand is held in this position, and this position is called claw hand. In claw hand, interphalangeal joints become flexed and metacarpophalangeal joints become extended. This condition is called claw hand. Understand now?
Yes.
So fracture to the surgical neck results in loss of abduction. And fracture of mid-shaft results in wrist drop. And fracture of supracondylar fracture results in claw hand.
That's it.
Joints, you have done. Any questions?
Thank you.
Any question? Any question? Now you ask.
Yeah, about the healing.
Healing, yes.
Can you know the nerve be healed or not?
Usually, when the nerve is cut, there is no regeneration. It depends on, there are many types of injury and necrosis, if there is Schwann cells are cut or not, it depends on. But this is separate topic, regeneration of the nerve, but generally speaking, we say no. No questions. Now, Ahmed will tell you about the eye drop.
Okay.
What
is the eye drop, Shabab? Exactly. سألنا يا احنا
متحمسين يا شباب
اتندنس يروح بيجي جاوب ضاوي يسار لا لا راح على بالي نعرفه طيب راح احس بنكته احس بحركه بالايد
لا انا راح بالي اي دروب زي طلعت كذا
تطيح يعني
الله العظيم راح بالي كذا نسبة يعني للريست
شباب قبل اروح ما شاف دقائق
في مشرحة.
Doctor Vala will come. Don't go.
Okay.
Stay.
Here in the lab.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Here are the. Thank you very much.